Oh yeah, no, I do have that. Field notes. I go out in the field a lot, you know? And my field notes are, text my doctor.
Are you telling me? Or?
That's all I wrote. Mm. Also, can Satan be saved?
Find out next time on...
I don't have the answer for that one.
I don't have the answer for that one.
So that video clip is from a YouTube show called Dope or Nope, featuring Michael Talamantes, Tanner Mamadol, and Matthew Frederick, otherwise known as Matthias. This YouTube show really has nothing to do with religion. It's a comedic show that features strange products from all over the internet. But that clip that I showed at the beginning is really where I got the topic for this video. Can Satan be saved? You might think that a little strange that I pulled that topic from that particular video, but honestly, I just get a little tickled when non-religious shows bring up religious topics. It just gets me excited for whatever reason. I'm also aware that Matthias, the one who posed the question, has gone through a bit of a faith journey over the last couple of years, and so I do think it's a question that he has genuinely thought about, so I also just want to help him out if I can and attempt to answer that question. So to answer this question, can Satan be saved, I think we need to first answer a couple more specific questions. First, I think we need to answer the question, do angelic beings have free will? Secondly, I think we need to ask the question, do angelic beings have souls that can either be saved or damned? In answering those two more specific questions, I think we can maybe come to a better understanding of the question, can Satan be saved? So let's attempt to answer this first minor question, do angelic beings have free will? To answer this question, I'm going to reference biblical texts that are traditionally seen as the story of the fall of Satan. The first source text that I'm going to reference is Ezekiel 28, 11 through 19. These verses generally follow the storyline of Lucifer becoming prideful in heaven, sinning against God, and then being cast out of heaven as punishment. We could also reference Isaiah chapter 14, starting in verse 12. These verses, again, follow the storyline of Lucifer becoming prideful and wanting to ascend to the place of God himself. And again, this led to his punishment and being cast out of heaven. And then a third source text that we have for this storyline of Lucifer sinning in heaven and then being cast out of heaven by God is in Revelation chapter 12. This passage again details the rebellion of Lucifer and the war that takes place in heaven as a result of that rebellion, and then the subsequent rebellion of a third of the angelic host with Lucifer, who all then got cast out of heaven for their rebellion. So in other words, this is the beginning of what we now call Satan and the demonic host, or Satan and his demons, right? When Lucifer fell and brought a third of the angelic host with him, he was then named Satan, which means adversary, and the evil angelic host are then referred to as demons. So let's not forget what we're trying to do here. We're trying to answer the question, do angelic beings have free will? And my point in bringing all three of these passages up is that I think those very clearly show us that yes, Lucifer, as well as the third of the angels that rebelled with him, did indeed have free will. They chose to rebel against God. They chose to attempt to elevate themselves to a position that was above God. So to answer our first question concisely, yes, I do believe angelic beings have free will, or at least they were created with free will. So now we need to answer our second question, which if you'll remember is, do angelic beings have souls that can either be saved or damned? So to answer this second question, I would take us to Matthew 25, verse 41. Jesus says that those who have rejected Christ will be cast into the eternal fire that was made for the devil and his angels. Now you may think, what does this have to do with angelic beings having souls? In this text, we learn that the eternal fire that Jesus is talking about was prepared for the devil and his angels, meaning that this is a place of damnation, this is a place of punishment that apparently was specifically made for Satan and his angels, or the devil and his angels. So this would seem to suggest that angelic beings can indeed be damned, because there was a place of damnation or punishment made specifically for Satan and his demons. So to recap, the answer to our first question, do angelic beings have free will, was yes, I believe they do have free will. And that's based on the three reference texts that I provided in Ezekiel, Isaiah, and Revelation. And to answer the second question, do angelic beings have souls that can either be damned or saved, we referenced Matthew 25:41, which seems to suggest that indeed angelic beings can at least be damned. Now you might realize that there was a crucial part left out of the answering of that second question, namely, can angelic beings be saved? We found out that they seem to be able to be damned, but can they be saved? And that's really the crux of this whole video, is it not? So let's think about this. If angelic beings have free will, and if angelic beings can be damned, that seems to lie in striking parallel with humanity, does it not? Humans have free will, and humans are able to be damned. Now, we know from the Bible that humans are also able to be saved. So one might think, well, is it not logical then to think that angels can also be saved, since they're in such close parallel with humans? To this I would say, not necessarily. There's a couple things that we still need to take into account. Now, seeing that parallel between humanity and the angelic, Let's consider humanity for a second. Let's consider human beings. Now, why are they able to be saved? Well, in the Old Testament, humans were able to be saved because God had mercy upon them. God was merciful. He was long-suffering. And therefore, he allowed people to make atonement for themselves. He allowed them a redemptive framework by which to pay for their own sins. And as long as these people remained in relationship with God in that way, God was merciful upon them. Now, in the New Testament, we have a completely different framework. We have a new covenant framework, which uses Jesus as the center of that atoning framework. Jesus atoned for our sins. Jesus is the atoning sacrifice by which we are redeemed to God. Unlike the Old Testament system, Jesus was a once and for all sacrifice, meaning that we no longer have to make animal sacrifices in order to please God. Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice to please God for all of humanity. Now, the key thing to realize here is that Jesus was the atoning sacrifice for humanity. There's no discussion in the Bible about Jesus dying for the angelic host. Jesus died for humanity. We're also not told of any other redemptive framework that is offered to the angelic host. We're not told of any sacrificial system or any framework of redemption that the angelic host can use to come into right relationship with God again. So we have to come to the conclusion then that though people are offered a redemptive framework, angels are not necessarily offered that same redemptive framework. And I think there's a very good reason for that. You have to remember that seemingly when the angelic host was created by God, they were created in God's presence to serve God face to face, essentially, to serve God in God's presence. They were in the ultimate position to know God, to see the workings of God, to know the character of God. So it seems logical to think that if an angelic being who starts out in such an ideal position, if that angelic being could indeed fall away, there would be much less grace and mercy given to that being because he started in such an ideal position to know God. Think about it. If you're in the presence of God daily, constantly even, worshiping God, seeing his character, seeing the power of his presence, if you fall away, that would be a situation that would be very hard to come back from because there's almost nothing more that could be done to convince you of the glory and the beauty of God. And so I would argue that it makes sense that there really is no redemptive framework for angels. If they fall, they have fallen from the ideal position. Now, this brings up an interesting question. We seem to have come to the conclusion that angels cannot be redeemed, meaning demons and Satan cannot be redeemed. They cannot be saved. But that brings up the question, can good angels or the good angelic host fall still? Are they still in a position where they could potentially fall away from God? That's an interesting question. That's one I don't know that I have a very definitive answer on. The only thing I would suggest is that there's a difference between the angelic host as it exists now and the angelic host as it existed before Lucifer and his angels fell. And that difference, I think, maybe is key in understanding this question, can good angels fall still? The difference in the angelic host in heaven now is that they witnessed the rebellion of Lucifer and his angels. They witnessed that horrific rebellion. They saw the consequences of that rebellion. And so I would argue that the thing that would keep the angels in heaven from rebelling now is their knowledge of how that rebellion went for their comrades, for Lucifer and his angels. They were able to see that rebellion. They were able to see the horrors of it. They were able to see the results of it and how it ultimately did not end well for Lucifer and his angels. I think when that rebellion happened, the angels that are still on the side of God learned a valuable lesson. They learned that rebellion is foolish. Rebellion is futile. Rebellion is stupid. It is not a good idea. It ends in tragedy. It ends in sorrow. It ends in pain. It ends in death. There's an interesting parallel to this idea that I've heard in the realm of apologetics from a man named Dr. Clay Jones. He suspects that one of the reasons God would allow people to suffer through their sin natures and suffer through tragedy on this earth is so that they will learn the utter foolishness and the utter horrors of sin. And so they can take that valuable information into eternity with them. And that will be kind of the ultimate sanctification process. When they go into eternity, they will fully realize the horrors and the foolishness of sin that they witnessed on earth. And that is valuable information that will be used in eternity. So having all that in mind, there is one last thing that I would offer as a argument that Satan cannot be saved. I think the last point that I would leave you with is what we saw in Matthew 25:41. The fact that a place of eternal damnation has been prepared for the devil and his angels seems to suggest that even if Satan could be saved and his angels could be saved, we seem to have a prediction that they will not be saved. In other words, a place has been created for their ultimate demise and their ultimate damnation. There seems to be a prediction in scripture that they will not be saved. Their rebellion is final. So I hope this video was informative as well as entertaining. Matthias, if you ever happen to see this video, I hope it answered your question. You know, I don't know if the question posed in that video was a bit or if it was actually a genuine question. I think it probably was a genuine question, at least at one point. But yeah, I hope that answered it, or at least got you on the right track to answering the question. So thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, consider subscribing to my channel and clicking the bell icon next to the subscribe button so that you can be notified of videos when they come out on my channel. Thanks for listening. Have a good one.